Trustee Chenoweth, your name has just been called for attendance. And you are here, okay. I need a motion to allow trustee Chenoweth to attend via electronic attendance.
So moved.
Second.
Roll call.
Trustees George Duberstein.
Aye.
Chris Chenoweth.
Aye.
Wally Crease.
Aye.
Mary Kogel.
Aye.
And George Ann Duberstein.
Aye.
Motion carried.
Okay, Jack, can you hear clearly?
I sure can.
Okay, thank you. Need a motion to approve the agenda? So moved.
Second.
Roll call.
Trustees George Duberstein.
Aye.
Chris Chenoweth.
Aye.
Wally Crease.
Aye.
Mary Kogel.
Aye.
Jack Chenoweth.
Aye.
And George Ann Duberstein.
Aye.
Motion carried.
Before we go to the public comments, we have four guests from Great Lakes Central. Mr. Rorks, is it government class or government class? He has sent many students to us, but we haven't left any bloody trails behind. So welcome. Hope you if you need selfies to prove you were here, we can work on that later at a small fee. All right, public comments. Ms. Richmond, you're up.
Just wanted to follow up on the radar cart on Teleco Drive. We talked about it at the August meeting. We put it on Centennial. We followed up on the...
They haven't moved it?
No, I haven't seen it.
Has it disappeared or is it still on Tall Oak?
It's never been on Tall Oak. It's where we like it. I haven't been on Centennial.
There's one on Centennial.
It's still sitting on Centennial?
Yeah.
Okay. I called the chief after the last one asked him to move it. I will call him again.
Excellent. My other question, this kind of ties into last month's, we discussed moving boats and RVs out of driveways by the end of October. Is there any ruling about box trucks parked in driveways?
The only ordinance that we have is based on the weight, overall weight of the truck. If it is a D starting on the license plate, it's legal. So beyond that, just a box truck, you don't have an ordinance to address it.
So if it's D is okay?
D is okay.
Okay.
Oh, wait a minute. No, D is okay. D is in dog is
commercial.
It has to do with weight.
Is up to a 3/4 ton.
It's a limitation of weight up to, I can't remember if it's 10,000 or 12,000 pounds. And if you're around for the end of the meeting, I will go log in my computer and get that answer for you.
Is it in the zoning?
In the zoning.
Is it listed in the zoning?
You might find it easier if you just look up Illinois Secretary of State.
Okay.
And ask for license plate categories. It'll tell you what the weights are, and then we still have to go back to the ordinance to find out exactly which one.
So under a certain weight is acceptable, over a certain weight
is not.
Is not.
Yes.
And that would be listed in the ordinance. Can I look up the ordinance on our website?
Yes, you should. Yeah. Yeah. I'm just thinking if the new ordinances are listed there or access to them,
Yeah, they are. They should be on the slider, and if they're not, then they're under announcements. News announcements.
Okay. I'll check with you. I noticed the my mobile version is a little different than the desktop version when I look at our website, but I'll dig around.
All right.
Thank you.
Over to Andrew Burstein.
Aye.
Motion carried.
Reports, finance.
Waiting on the audit to be finished. Other than that, nothing new.
Yeah, they're very close on the audit. We should have it presented at the next meeting in November. So once we get it up, open it up.
All right, thank you. Public Works, Wally?
Yeah.
Meeting with Tim, I was actually not with the ministry and stuff like that. We were discussing the budget, what we were thinking about next year and stuff like that, and also going over some of the things that has happened in the past couple of weeks, and they've pretty much concentrated on trees, on removals, and planting. They also had a Civil War event, which was a great, you know, thanks to you for all your hard work at that. Moving forward, like I said, we were going to talk about the budget and what Tim, some little wish list is, okay, and some of the equipment. We'll discuss that and come up with something. And after that, I'm going to actually read Tim's report. Okay, listed below are items the Public Works Department is working on and were completed over this month. Public Works employees have attended Lake County's de-icing course for roads. This class is intended to educate persons in municipal and snow removal fields on the complete process of how to properly remove snow and apply salt or liquids to make the roads and walkways as safe as can be, while limiting the adverse effects to the environment. As we all know, there are many waterways in Hainesville, and this is crucial to protecting our nature of all forms. Also, there was one large hempwood and a cluster of five medium sand willows have been removed. These are the trees from the lot north of 41 Brittany. I got it. Lane. The cottonwood was completely dead and rotting, posing danger to the nearby homes. The cluster of sand willows was growing in the entrance to the drain that connects the Lake Lisk Pond to the wetland area near Misty Hill Lane and Route 120. New swale has been put in for proper water flow through this pipe. The week of October 11th and 15th, we helped with the setup and maintenance of the Civil War event. This included setting up signs, mowing, moving bait bales, and moving and handing out firewood to the reenactors, to name a few things. The event was October 16th and 17th, and from what I hear, it was a great success this year. Three medium to large parkway trees that were dead and endangered have been removed at 271 Deer Lake, 125 Aspen, and 216 Littleton. They were on the list for replacement next year. Okay. Julie locates have been issued for all these trees taken down since May that need stump grinding. Stump grinding should commence this week. And we've been clearing out our public works lots of our gathered debris from the summer projects in the near future. We have lots of concrete, asphalt, and trees that need to be moved and chipped before the snow falls. And winter prep and tree clearing will be continued throughout November. And they also hired a new public works seasonal, which brings a total to three people in the public works department. And that's about it. All right, thank you. Any questions or comments for Wally?
Just a question. I noticed our website still advertises for help.
Under 12 hours.
Hmm?
Oh, I'm sorry.
I took it off yesterday because I asked Tim about it. And Tim said that they're good for the winter.
Oh, perfect. That's how I was just wondering if we did that.
So I took it off yesterday.
Okay.
All right. Thank you, Wally. Community events, George.
Okay, a couple items. One is just a kind of an anthrax report on the Civil War event we had this weekend. Was a great success from my point of view. We got very positive comments from the public that I've talked to and some of the reenactors as well. I really want to thank our sponsors and the Northbrook Sports Club for hosting it. And we got a lot of decent help from Georgianne and Mary and Wally, and I appreciate that. And of course, the support that we get throughout the year from the staff. And we also were very fortunate to have student volunteers from Grays Lake North, Grays Lake Central, and Round Lake High Schools. And we had the representation from police and fire departments, so that was good. We had about 1,000 people there with something like 500 cars, which is more than we've had in the past, so that was quite a bit. And when I did a little evaluation of our budget versus the income that we got from the sponsors and the parking fees, I was pleasantly surprised that we were considerably in the black. So that's good news. It was about a little less than 150 reenactors there, and because we didn't get all the cannons and horses that we budgeted for, we'll be getting some money back from that as well. So anybody have any particular questions? Dan?
Well, other than job well done, George. Both times I was there, it was smooth. Talked to a number of reenactors. They obviously enjoy coming. And once again, you worked the weather miracle.
Well, I have this conversation with the weather guards.
Excellent job. Excellent. Good work. And I know, and Georgianne, thank you too, sitting out there in that tent one day and not the next. Huddle up and warm clothes. Both of you do a lot of good work on this. Thank you very much.
Appreciate it. The other subject is the emergency operation plan. I finally got a response. I guess he's been tied up with reviewing 40 other plans. So I finally got a response from Lake County. You got a 200-page plan that we submitted, or that we worked on, and I gave him. But he's also sent me 7 other documents to have to look at. So take a little bit of time to look at. That's what I'm about.
Do you have enough years left in your term?
I don't know.
Way to go. All right. Thank you, sir. Anything else?
No.
All right. George, did you ever get a number in previous years as to how many reenactors we had, just to compare?
No, not really, but looking at what we had just from a, and I look, I'd say we've had a few more this time around than we did before.
Nor still one, didn't it?
Yeah.
Cool. All right, thank you, sir. Great Age Club, George, again.
There's nothing really new, nothing special going on right now. Great Age Club. As far as our new beautification plan for the gardens of the village, everything was planted today, and I have some pictures that hopefully we'll get out on the website to show the new look for spring. They did a great job. It really fast and efficient, and it worked good.
It's a good plan. We did a lot of work today. Thank you. Okay, nothing about Great Age Club?
No, there's really nothing.
Okay.
Oh, on transportation, I got a note from Linda Soto. She's our representative of Lake County on the PACE board. They're going to do a test with 2 electric buses to see how that goes before they invest in having everything turn over to be
before what?
Before they convert the whole fleet.
Do you get a charge out of that?
I don't know.
Anything else, Virginia? Okay, add on, Wally. Oh, okay, here you go. recommendation of the ad hoc committee for removal and replacement of our parkway trees is as such.
trees in our parkways on property of the village. There is no cost to our residents for removal of a tree, from the parkway. The village will not remove trees that are not on village property. So the village should not remove any trees unless it is dying, death, or hazard to public safety. Replacement of parkway trees. The village will fund the cost of the parkway tree replacement. The village should make every attempt to replace any tree removed with another. The ad hoc committee does not recommend planting trees within our parkways with sidewalks. As these locations, it has created safety hazards in the past and caused the village undue cost and labor to correct. And what's happened is it raises the sidewalks and not much more to replace the sidewalks. So that's been ongoing. And we do have a couple of locations where the apron is big enough that we can probably, we can plant the trees there because of the growth. The tree is growing and stuff like that, and too big for it. But if the village cannot replace the tree in the same location, then it should contact the resident where the tree was located, inquire if the resident would like a tree planted on his property at no cost to the resident, but also inform the resident that from then on, it is the resident's tree. The village has no liability and will not maintain it. Okay. If no resident accepts our offer for a tree to be planted, then the village can find another location on village property for which to plant it. Residents should not be allowed to plant a tree within a parkway or village easement without village approval. And for any tree to be planted in an easement or approval by the village of and approval by the village of its location, the village will look at the tree's mature height and circumference before approving the tree and the location that it has to be planted. Any questions?
Okay. Wally was at standalone ad hoc committee and researched this through communication to a number of other communities. Any thoughts or questions or responses?
Yeah, I have some. I realize that with my advancing age, I may have lost a few brain cells. But this one sentence here doesn't make any sense to me.
Okay.
When you talk about parkways, you're talking about that area that's between the sidewalk and the road?
Yes. But actually, if you look at the parkway, okay, well, the easement, okay, what we found out, the village easement, okay, is 25 feet from the center of the road on both sides.
Okay.
And that's what we call the parkway.
The problem area, though, George, is just you said between the sidewalk and the curbs.
No, but and that's where we have all the trees, right?
Pretty much. Except on the other side of the road where there's no sidewalk.
Yeah. No.
You're right.
Well, my point is, you said this one sentence here says we're not going to plant any trees, or it's not recommended planting a tree within our parkways with sidewalks. I don't understand what that means.
It means that from now on, okay,
yeah,
if a tree is going to be planted, we recommend not to plant in that area where there's a sidewalk that is too small, you know, and the apron there between the street and the sidewalk is too small for a tree to be planted, because what we have right now, especially in the sanctuary end of Deer Point, okay, is we have a six foot apron between the sidewalk and the curb.
All right.
And that's what I'm talking about.
What you're really saying is you need to put another qualifier there to say what the distance would be, because we have trees in the parkway where there are sidewalks now.
Well, right. Well, but what I'm saying is if we ever remove those trees, which we're going to be removing a lot of them, because if you walk
by us, you won't necessarily place them if the distance is not too great.
Too great.
Right.
Right, that's all I mean. Yeah, and I should put it that way.
Yeah.
Okay.
As I said, I mean, we lost a few brain cells.
No. Wait, your right question. Other questions or comments, you all? All right, thank you, sir. Madam Clerk?
We received our certificate regarding our census count, which is 3,546. And then I was contacted by Katie from Run Lake Area Park District regarding, they had a trick or treat trail event, which was October.
Can you take your mask off? I'm having trouble. Thank you.
Yep, trick or treat trail event from Run Lake Park District. It was on October 16th. They had crafts, hay rides, and handed out candy. They asked if we wanted to have a table to hand out candy. What we did is we made a donation of $50 for the candy, and they acknowledged us as a sponsor. So we received a thank you letter from them that they had a wonderful turnout. The weather was nice. And that's all I have.
They probably talked to George about the weather.
Yeah.
All right, thank you, Kim.
Well, we asked for no rain. We just forgot to ask for warmth.
Yeah.
Next year we'll learn. All right. We now have to discuss the Hainesville sewer fee. We are currently charged 50 cents per 1,000 gallons. Prior to the pandemic, we passed an ordinance to raise that to $1 per 1,000 gallons to help continue or to help build our contingency fund or our reserve fund. Pandemic hit, we revoked that. I want you to discuss whether or not we should reinstate that. You're aware of various water work projects we have coming up, the potential of a well, the close to $900,000 to expend on the lift station repair, which some of the money may come out of reserve for that. Remember, capital is being paid for by ARPA. So I'm interested in your feedback on whether or not we should raise that. If I recall correctly, Kelly, it would be roughly an increase of $36,000. $37,000 in revenue.
Two points. One, if there was a rationale for doing it in the first place, it would seem we would want to do it again. On the other hand, Kelly, do you have any idea, on average, what the increase would be for an individual ratepayer?
I don't have those figures, but basically if a user of water system uses 8,000 gallons, it would be 8,000 times 50 cents currently. So, you know, we're just talking about doubling that to a dollar. So it might be a $4 increase on an average water bill of a user of 8,000 gallons.
For a month.
Yeah.
Okay. Other thoughts?
Yes. I'm a little uncomfortable collecting money
to retain here.
Fair enough. If this isn't something that's going to affect our sewers, I mean, is this something, are you equating the well system with the sewer system?
Yes.
I mean, sort of, is it, can we
it all justify, comes out of the water fund?
Yeah, can we justify it that way? Because I would prefer that the money that we collect has a purpose rather than just putting it in the general reserve. If that we see that we're going to have to replace parts of it in the next few years, and that's why we're raising the price to have a reserve for the work on the sewers rather than just have it in the general fund. I don't know if that makes any sense.
This money, if approved, would go to the water reserve fund for water or sewer projects.
Okay.
Accurate?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. And we have the two major reserve accounts, one for water and one for general. This would be specifically water fund.
Okay. I just wanted to be clear.
All right.
Yes.
Other questions or comments? Yay, nay? I mean, we're not voting. Based on the conversation tonight, we'll have this on the agenda next month for a vote.
I believe it's needed.
Okay.
So since, like I said, we're looking at the lift stations and being a $900,000 repair and upgrade to upgrade our lift stations, which haven't been upgraded since they've been put in, okay? And I think the more longer we wait on all of it, on that, the more we might end up being in trouble. So I think putting funds in there to help build that fund, okay, in case we have, do have a major breakdown, whether it's going to be in the sewer line or, you know, whatever. We already know it's over $900,000 for the repairs. And then we look at, you know, and if we have a sewer line that goes bad, who knows what's going to cost. And I think that we really need to build up that fund so we have reserves available, so we're not going to be going out and saying, oh my gosh, we need to borrow money to do a repair.
Two thoughts from my end. One, it was long-range planning by a couple of members on this board that were on some engineering a few years ago that led us to the water rate increase that helped us build our water reserve. So we are in good financial position because we've planned ahead. Just think of some of the things we've covered in the last few years. The air relief valves that blew out when we had replaced 17 of them, wasn't planned for. As Wally has mentioned, and I've mentioned before, the lift stations hadn't been done. Water tower communication equipment. I think it's wise for the board, and we've done a good job of it in the past, to think ahead. Jack, so I don't ignore you, anything on your end?
No, I agree with Wally and with you there. I think we should be proactive.
Okay. Any other thoughts or comments? Judging from the reaction tonight, we'll be on next month's agenda for approval. And Kelly, we were talking about if it gets approved, what sort of timeline?
We were talking about having an effective in the new fiscal year, May 1st, 2022.
Okay. All right, we'll be on next month's agenda. Thank you. I need a motion to approve an extension of the 2018-19 to 2021 winter season snow and ice removal contract between the building of Hainesville and Dave Schultz for a period of 6 months until April 2022.
So moved.
Second. Discussion? Roll call.
Trustees George Duberstein.
Aye.
Christian Alves.
Aye.
Wally Priest.
Aye.
Mary Koppel.
Aye.
Jack Schnalwitz.
Aye.
And George Ann Duberstein.
Aye.
Motion carried.
Need a motion to approve an ordinance adopting the annual tax levy for Cranberry Lake Special Service Area Number 1 of the Village of Hainesville. I do have the note, but this will maintain the level that it's been at.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Trustees George Duberstein.
Aye.
Christian Alves.
Aye.
Wally Priest.
Aye.
Mary Koppel.
Aye.
Jack Schnalwitz.
Aye.
And George Ann Duberstein.
Aye.
Motion carried, ordinance number 21-10-320.
If I may, just one comment for the benefit of the students that are here. You may notice that we quickly approve some of these things that have come across and without discussion, but that doesn't mean we're rubber stamping. If we get a big packet beforehand to go through these things in detail, and if we already have any objections or questions, we can deal with them beforehand so we don't take a lot of time in the meeting.
Are you also a student back there?
Yeah.
And you almost slipped by my attention. Are you two from Central?
Yeah.
Welcome. Should I make her stand up and identify herself? Okay, I need a motion to approve the tax levy ordinance for the tax year 2021.
So moved.
Second.
Roll call.
Trustees George Duberstein.
Aye.
Christian Alves.
Aye.
Wally Priest.
Aye.
Mary Koppel.
Aye.
Jack Schnalwitz.
Aye.
And George Ann Duberstein.
Aye.
Motion number 2110-321.
Okay, need a motion to approve the renewal of our Illinois Municipal Legal Risk Management Association insurance for $29,641.59 for the year 2022. So moved.
Second.
Kelly, how does this rate compare?
Our rates have been holding steady for the, this is our third year in a row that it's been holding steady. We did go back out and look at other coverages a couple of years ago, and being in this pooled insurance with Illinois Municipal League Risk Management Association is the best option for our village. We have very well good coverage, and again, our rates have been, like the mayor said, the renewal cost is $29,641, and the last 2 years was $29,700, so it's actually a little bit lower. And we've had years as high as $37,902 back in 2009. So this is nice to see that our rates are actually lower than what they were many years ago.
Thank you, Kelly. Roll call.
Trustees George Duberstein.
Aye.
Chris Chenoweth.
Aye.
Wally Kreese.
Aye.
Mary Koval.
Aye.
Jack Chenoweth.
Aye.
And Georgianne Duberstein.
Aye.
Motion carried.
Need a motion to approve the on-sol contract for Code Red for the year November 2021 to November 2024 for a total of $9,007.24, which is $2.41 per year. This will replace our CPI board.
So moved.
Second. Roll call.
Trustees George Duberstein.
Aye.
Chris Chenoweth.
Aye.
Wally Kreese.
Aye.
Mary Koval.
Aye.
Jack Chenoweth.
Aye.
And Georgianne Duberstein.
Aye.
Motion carried.
Need a motion to approve the ILM emergent mowing proposal from October 2021 to December 2021 for $3,600. So moved.
Second.
Discussion?
Yeah, I've got a couple of points. Microphone, please. Mayor, you and I had a discussion offline about one issue here, which I'm satisfied with, so I'm not going to address that. But the more I think about it, the concern I have is if we move this thing from the path to the lake, it'll give more impetus for anybody who wants to use the lake. And I know there is some, you feel that this is a public lake, but given the fact that the ecologists have said this is a Pierce Lake in Maine County, and that any boating or swimming or any other activity on the lake will contaminate the lake and affect some of the endangered species there in, I just have a little concern about it. So,
can we change the word would contaminate to could?
Yeah, we could say that.
It might. The endangered species, there's one, the bladderwort,
right,
which even our ecologist said it could be endangered, but it's not protected. But go ahead, sir.
Well, I'm not going to belabor the point. I'm just going to, and I know that probably the rest of the board is going to approve this anyway, but just for a matter of history, I'm going to object to this. So my vote is nay.
All right, we have a call for the vote yes. Okay, any other comments? I understand your point, George. We do not agree on the restriction of access, and that's one of the joys of being on the public board. We're allowed our own opinions. The purpose, as I briefly explained, is to help us decide how to move forward with
previous mayor once described the lake as the diamond of Hainesville, where a diamond can't be seen by hardly anyone in its current condition. ILM and I, I've been talking about this for years, what to do with the cattails. In the latest conversation with the ILM representative, she came up with the suggestion, let's cut a test batch, find out what's there. So if we understand what is there, is it just mud? Is it, is there another seed bed underneath it? Could help us come up with a plan on how to proceed. This is not to be perceived, I don't want it to be perceived as, oh, we're gonna go out after we cut this budget for next year and just cut it all down. There is no plan beyond this other than to study what's there and try to develop a plan that makes sense. Other thoughts or comments before the vote?
Now, I know you said it was gonna be in the southeast corner. I think that's where the cattails come all the way to the path, or close to it. Because if in the future we would do other sections, they would only start where the cattails start, not just mow down the whole.
Yeah, no, we're not talking about mowing down everything. Even the equipment they have now is controlled. It's the same sort of equipment that they've used on the channelization over the last number of years. It cuts where they make it cut. Okay? And if you've seen some of the sites, for example, not this year, but last year, they had to get their entranceway was between 2 yards. They laid down plywood, traversed the plywood, and afterwards, when that came up, they repaired the yards back to what it was. Any other comments? Discussion?
I don't remember. I'm sure you show, what's the width of this? I know that it's
going to
be the length.
Oh gosh, it's a total of a half acre.
I thought it had something like
50 feet by 100, 2 miles long.
Okay. Okay.
Is it a good number? Yeah, it's a half acre, but I can't remember. All right, any other comments? Roll call, please.
100 feet wide.
Oh, 100 feet wide.
Mm-hmm. Trustees George Duberstein.
Nay.
Christian Alwith.
Aye.
Wally Kreese.
Aye.
Mary Koval.
Aye.
Jack Schnallith.
Aye.
And Georgianne Duberstein.
Aye.
What?
Aye.
Motion carried.
Need a motion to adjourn at 7:09.
So moved.